Okay, here we go. We are live, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Robert Patton. I'm the CEO of Sheath Underwear. This is the Robert Patton Global Podcast, rebranded, formerly the Sheath Podcast. And it's available on YouTube. And, you know, we'll share it on Facebook and Instagram. We are very happy to have a very special guest here with us today, Isaac Stackhouse, a old friend, if you will.
Yeah.
We met
through the internet, didn't we? Through Instagram.
Yeah. I mean, I think we were both following Gary Vaynerchuk, and somehow that was what brought us together. You were like a big fan of the Gary V, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I was following his stuff early on when I first got involved in the marketing world. So,
yeah. Me too. And then we ended up flying to Los Angeles for a Vayner Sports event. And
yeah, that was crazy.
That was crazy. You met us there, but, you know, I was mentioning it in a live recently on Instagram how, you know, I spent $15,000 to go to this Gary V event and all I got was this lousy hat.
I still have the hat.
Yeah. So, that was cool. But what have you been up to lately? I know you had a fight recently.
Yeah, I recently got back in the cage. I took kind of a year off kind of figuring out some things, going through gym politics and, you know, learning where I wanted to kind of land as I was advancing my career as an MMA fighter. And so that led me to Atlanta, where I'm training among a bunch of different places, but I'm training with Kenny Kim, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu up there in Marietta, and a couple other guys throughout a couple different gyms. And so stepped back in the cage in February.
Yeah.
Three-round war against a dude named Steven. He's coming up. He was a really, really good fighter. I chose to play a more jiu-jitsu-based game, and that didn't impress the judges.
Because it went to the end? It went to the judges?
Yeah. So we had a decision, but I was really happy with the performance. There was a lot of growth that I had, and so I'm working on kind of steering towards dropping down into a lower weight class and kind of really getting competitive now. So I had a great time. Every time I fight, man, I absolutely love it.
Yeah, tell me about that. Do you, you know, get into quote-unquote the zone when you get into the cage, or like how does your mind respond? Is it their fear or just calm?
Man, funny enough, I was just rereading the book that was a while ago. I can't remember how many years ago, but and it's somewhere around here. But it's the there it is. It's The Rise of Superman.
Oh, yeah.
By Stephen, and I'm going to butcher his last name, Coulter. But I was rereading that because back when, right when I had started fighting, I've always been what people would deem like an adrenaline junkie. Like, I was always the kid that was like jumping off of tall stuff and trying to find the next exciting thing. I played football all through high school. I mean, I'm from the South, you know, everybody played football. So, but I ended up playing in college, and you know, I was always like running as fast as I could to the next exciting thing. I was a kayaker, a rock climber, all the different kinds of things. And so I found that book, I think at some point while I was in college, and the first time that I'd heard people like really kind of talk about being in the zone. And so like when I talk about like going into the cage for me is it's the closest thing like between life and death is what a lot of people talk about, and that's like an over exaggeration. I know, but
not really.
But you get to push to that edge of testing everything you've ever thought, trained, your mental stability, your ability to control all those emotions at that time is really like that's the experience I'm going for when I'm going in there, and you know, going in there and protecting myself, you know, because ultimately that's what we train for.
In that like life or death scenario, quote unquote, even though it's not really life or death, you're kind of fighting for your life. I mean, your ego's life anyways. And usually that's what it takes to get into the zone. I believe I've read that book or I've listened to portions of it, and it takes being like a super expert in something and then putting yourself in a situation where you have to perform to sort of kick it in to gear.
Yeah, the biggest story that I remember from that book is, and like I said, I'm just now getting to where I'm rereading it, and there was the story about the guys that did the on the Transformers movie. I can't remember which Transformers movie it was, but where they did the wingsuit flight through, I think it was Chicago, which is the Windy City. So like, it was all these crazy things that these guys trained for like a year and a half, to the point that like the guy that was flying second, as he was flying through the air, his signal to like make sure he didn't plow into everybody else was the guy in front of him's foot would twitch. And he knew that that was a millisecond before he was going to start turning. And so when he would see his foot twitch, he would start turning so that they would, that was all avoiding calamity. That's the most split second decision you can think of. And so I guess for me, MMA has become that outlet of where that was.
Just, but yeah, like being able to respond to the other person's little minor millisecond of a twitch and being ahead of
Yeah.
it.
It's the pattern recognition is really
Pattern recognition.
the book that I really took away from that was that they found in the athletes that were in these extreme sports, our ability to break down pattern recognition in a really, really small and minute amount of time to make a change that's so small that like the untrained person has no idea that that just happened.
Right. I mean, I would, for me, not that it's about me, this is about you, but like I played basketball for decades now, and but when I was in high school and I was playing basketball, I was still really fresh. I didn't have that, I was definitely not an expert, so I was never in the zone. But like now when I go play just by myself or on a, especially when I'm playing against other people, like it's so ingrained in my muscle memory that I can read where the ball is going to be. I can read what my opponent's going to do because I've seen this situation so many times, and basketball doesn't evolve like jiu-jitsu or mixed martial arts has over the years. It's kind of has stayed the same, which is
Yeah.
so it's allowed me to because I mean, I consider myself somewhat of an expert, and just watching it back in the day when Jordan was playing against the Boston Celtics, and just you might be a little bit too young for that, but it was magic, and it's inspiring, it's awe-inspiring. And that reminds me of another thing I just watched yesterday, which is called Free Solo on
Yeah.
National Geographic. Did you watch that?
I haven't watched that, but I've watched all the behind the scenes, and I've been following, and I can't think of his name right now.
Alex
Yeah, Alex.
Honnold.
Yeah, that is insane. I've followed him for a long time, and like I've always kind of like been fascinated with everything he does, but like that right there just blows my mind. What was even crazier was have you watched the New York Times bit that they did talking to the filmographer or the videographer?
Jimmy.
That, yeah, his buddy, like to have accepted your friend's death already, to be like, I've already accepted that how I'm gonna take it to market once I know that he's dead, and like I'm gonna finish the film that way.
I
Like, it was like, oh
know.
my God.
Well, I don't want to spoil the ending, but that would have been a horrible way to end
Well,
the
I mean, we all
movie.
know that he's still alive. I mean, he's doing
Okay, good.
interviews, so I
But I mean, I
don't think we
was.
have to put spoilers out there.
Okay, good. Because I was talking to my girlfriend, and I watched it twice yesterday because it was
Yeah.
so fascinating, and but he had to go through that route, like 100 times and take notes and just exact precise movements for every step of like thousands of steps up this El Capitan. I guess
Yeah.
it's in Yosemite or something, and it's a massive wall that, it
It's
was.
insane. I like I've done some climb like very like I am an amateur when it comes to climbing, and like that's just it blows my mind. And have like do you know much of the history about the climbing on that face? The like the first time they did it, I think it took something like 2 years, and that was like assisted with like ropes and like climb. So like the fact that he's doing this without ropes and like record time and doing like nuts. Like the physics, like the confidence you have to have in your abilities is just
Yeah,
that's
there has to be no doubt, right? It has to be like 100%, no fear. They did a brain scan on him, and this is all stuff that we, as you know, aspiring successful entrepreneurs or whatever, want to achieve in ourselves, is this level of no fear and just total confidence and pushing forward to make your dreams come true. And that's kind of like what he did. And I know you're a advertising type of a agent, and you do mixed martial arts, which is really cool to have that balance of you're not just always kind of in work mode and some on your computer. You can get physical and express that side of life,
because
that's necessary. And I mean, for me, I play basketball. I'm on this 100 burpees. This is for 100 days kind of challenge.
Yeah.
And that's been really good for me physically. And we all need to incorporate both the mental and physical, and then spiritual will come.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Speaking of spiritual, have you ever done any psychedelics?
Man, I haven't. And I have, you know, had my college years and things like that. But I just had a conversation sitting down on my podcast a couple weeks ago with a friend of mine that went down to the Peru to do one of the ayahuasca retreats, and that was my friend Taylor. And she had like all kinds of great things to say about it. I've definitely had my interest piqued towards some of the stuff on that realm. That was a really interesting conversation.
What's your podcast called? The Daily Stat?
It's The Daily Stat.
Okay. Yeah, I love that. That's such a cool logo too. I love your logo and everything.
yeah. That's my little sister actually made it for me back when I first started MMA. I needed a walkout shirt, and that's what we came up with. And so I've kind of, you know, leaned into the brand a little bit.
I feel you.
Beard. But
well, okay. So I guess not the reason I asked, but I actually did ayahuasca.
Oh, did you?
This past weekend. And I mean, I hear all the great things.
Did you have any answers? Did you get any answers from the aliens or from like anything? Did you come back with anything huge?
I was hoping to get some visit, some insight, you know, some sort of message from the mother of Earth, you know, Gaia. And ultimately, there was a lot of throwing up. We call it purging. And
sweet way of putting it. Yeah.
Yeah. But then you end up purging out both ends, not to get too graphic, but it was a 2-day affair. We were supposed to do 3 separate ceremonies. The first night was a nightmare. All I did was throw up like all night, did not even see one little swirly, no walls breathing or nothing. And I was like, I didn't want to do it again. I'm like, why am I going to sign up to throw up
for another whole round?
Yeah, and 2 more times. And I was like freaking out the next morning because we started at midnight. I slept like 1 hour. We were supposed to start the second ceremony at 10 a.m. the next morning. And I'm like, this is absurd. But in order to leave, because I kind of just wanted to leave, I had to talk to the Taita, they called him, a shaman.
Right.
And he essentially told me that I needed to do it at least 1 more time. And so, and I agreed to that because he said, like, the first one was kind of preparing your body for the medicine. And it was, you know, like, kind of just opening up the cell walls of your intestines to receive the medicine. And so I was like, okay. And it kind of gave me a sense of relief. Okay, well, at least I'm not going to do it 2 more times. I'm just going to do it 1 more time, and I'm going to give it a shot. So I drank the cup and I threw up again a bunch of times. And then I was like, okay, should I take 1 more cup? And it's usually the second cup that kind of kicks it in. So I take the second cup, and I actually did feel like the medicine, or it was like you're tripping hard on mushrooms. It wasn't like I still didn't get the visit. I still didn't get any insights. Like there's nothing that came to me and like showed me a direct path of like, here's what you need to do to make your goals come true or whatever. Cause maybe it wasn't that potent of a brew, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, for you, I mean, I don't know why I just assumed that was something you would be into. Are you just like super straight edge?
No, not super straight edge. Just there's the as far as, well, one, there's the legality of being able to do it anywhere where a near convenience was. And then the I've always known that psychedelics are something that can mold your mind and kind of like build something or tear something down. So like you really need to be in the right proper place. Cause I think after talking to Taylor, especially on my podcast last time was, you know, there's a lot of abilities to help people like where they've found it's helped not just ayahuasca, but like psychedelics in general have helped people like soldiers with PTSD and, you know, people that suffer from things like that, where they've found different avenues to treat things. I think there's definitely things there, but you need to be in the proper place in your own mind in the preparation. So I was going to ask you, because like that was the big thing that Taylor was talking about when she went in, what all did you do to prepare for this?
Yeah.
To get you ready. Did you do the diet and all that?
No. And I think that's a good, very good point. I on the way there, it was like 4 p.m. I stopped off at Rudy's Roadhouse and got some barbecue and, you know, barbecue brisket.
Why you puked for the whole time.
No. Everybody, we all had our own buckets. Okay?
Yeah. So buckets, everybody that was, sounds so awful.
What was more awful was when everybody took their individual buckets and poured it into the group bucket. And there was like a group bucket of vomit. And every time someone else would vomit, I would vomit again. Because you're hearing, you know how it's like contagious?
Yeah.
I'm sitting there, I'm like, I'm trying not to throw up. And then I hear someone else and I'm like, and I'm feeling it right now as I speak, actually. It was horrible. But so there's two sides to the story. We only hear the glamorous visions and
I saw the aliens and they told me everything and I know the secret to life.
But then you see these guys, like I have a friend that did it also like a few years ago, you know, and you come back, you're enlightened for like 4 days, but then all of a sudden you're back to your old selfish ways, you're smoking cigarettes again, you're just not living that the message that you received. We tend to slip back into our old habits. So it's what you do afterwards that is really important. It's not going to cure you. It's going to give you maybe some insights if you're lucky.
I think there's nothing that's a cure-all. That's the problem. And I think that's the problem that we have in our current society with the pill problems that we have as a society and all that is we want to throw one single pill at it as opposed to, hey, maybe you should just change your diet. Hey, maybe you should like go for a walk every once in a while.
Dude, exercise. Like, yes.
Right. Yeah. Like maybe you should mix up, you know, your routine, those type of things. Like people want just this big blanket. So like psychedelics, like anything, like it's just going to be a problem. If you go and you decide you want to explore your mind and you want to take LSD every weekend, I mean, be my guest, but you're going to be like muddling up your brain and you're not going to be able to differentiate and there's going to be all kinds of different things going. There'll be consequences to overdoing anything.
Yeah. So, I mean, so there was you spoke about soldiers with PTSD coming back from Iraq, and I'm one of them, you know, like can get into what I saw over there, lots of dead bodies, but, like you said, I mean, we want a pill, Abilify or Prozac or some size Xanax or Vicodin, you know, to take the pain away. But I think
people don't want to do the pre-work to get ready for it. Like, so that's what I'm saying is like everybody I've talked to has had like the really good experiences, air quotes, have been ones that like they like diligently for 3 months like made sure that they were eating nothing but these types of plants and like they were making sure that these type of things were in their systems and then like when they went in they were like they were clean by mind, body and soul like going into the process, because it's one of those things that like if you take it lightly, that which is why they're, you know, you're going to these places where there are like ancient shamanistic like rituals, they're there for a reason, like there were safe ways to do this. And I think that like where a lot of people talk about this type of thing, and this is just purely what I've read, like as far as the people that really advocate for it, is it's got to be done in the proper like channels. Because if you do it in the wrong mindset, in the wrong body set, in the wrong like anything, it's gonna be a bad time. It's the South Park. If you're gonna pizza when you want a French fry, you're gonna have a bad time.
I agree. And I think that's a part of it. However, a lot of the people that were there kind of confirmed my experience on the first night that it just like nothing happened. So not sure exactly what was the cause of it. I'm kind of like very experienced in these type like with like psilocybin and LSD and things like that. So if it was going to work, it was going to work. But that what you're saying, if I had prepared and prepped and fasted and purified,
maybe
it probably would have worked a little
bit. Or maybe it wasn't what you needed or what your mind needed to be expanded or to be opened or to be whatever you want to talk about.
No, that's very true too. I feel like I don't really need it. And some people do need it. I think I'm past that part of like, I mean, my PTSD, whatever, is it gone? Is it still there? I can't quite tell because I don't sleep very well. Speaking of sleep, how do you sleep? Do you sleep like a baby?
I sleep like, I mean, when I'm training, majority of the time, I'm training 4 or 5 times, like, in a very short amount of time because of, like, the way that my living situation is, like, I live about 2 hours away from Atlanta, and so that's how I get the training that I get is I go to Atlanta. So I'll go for, like, 4 days at a time, 5 days at a time, and then I'll train like 2-3 times a day.
Yeah.
And so like literally I'm just falling into a pillow. And then when I'm back at home, I'm running which I'm always having to run my business, and I've got different film projects and different videography things that I'm doing, and a lot of different projects. So majority of the time I'm just working till I pass out.
That's so cool. Then you sleep just like 8 hours and then you wake up and you're a new man.
I'm somebody that I have to sleep either like the 4 to 6 hour range.
Oh, really?
Or yeah, I don't do well. I messed up. I worked on an ambulance for 3.5 years.
Uh-huh.
And like that was when I was like 22, 23 years old. So like I got this sleep schedule that was all out of whack where I was used to, you know, working at 3 o'clock in the morning. And then I came off of working on an ambulance and started working on a line crew, like on big power lines, like climbing poles and stuff like that. And so like, I've never had a normal sleep schedule for majority of my 20s. And so that's now turned into like, if I sleep more than 6 hours, I'm exhausted all the time. So like, I usually get like between 4 to 6 hours.
Wow. So, okay. That makes me feel a little bit better about myself, because I've been struggling with sleep for about a decade now. And I just had surgery. I think you're aware of that.
Yeah. You had tonsillitis, right?
Yeah. They took my they took my tonsils out so that I could breathe better, because they said, the surgeon, she was like, these are the biggest tonsils I've ever seen. Shout out. And like, she's like, it was a major problem. And then they fixed my deviated septum. So just because I had sleep apnea, and now that that's fixed and I'm healed, I'm definitely sleeping better, but it's like in these weird little 3-hour bursts.
I've never had sleep apnea, but both my grandfathers had it, and my old partner on the ambulance had it. So like, I've seen it up close, and I was like, I hate that. Like, I can imagine that's a tear on your sleep.
It was bad. And then, like you said, it kind of maybe created this pattern for my body to just wake up every so often, and it's like trained it that way. And it just fascinates me. I mean, and there's so many products out there that they sell, like, we're gonna get you the best night of sleep ever with MyPillow, you know.
I'll be honest, like, I had like pretty, like, in my 20s, like, I had pretty bad like, just couldn't sleep, sleep insomnia, and that's just because I was an anxious kid. Like, I was always like trying to, and it's mostly because like school was really frustrating for me, so like I was always like worried about like trying, like I had to really try hard to make great good grades. Like I could make good grades, but it was a lot of work for me. And so like I was always like stressed out about that. And then like I've always had like little social anxiety things like my whole life. And so like that built into some like sleep problems in my early 20s. And I'll be honest, like I used to like poo-poo this, but there used to be, now YouTube's super weird and you can't just leave it running anymore. You know, Momo might pop up on you. Yeah. But that you could go on YouTube and find these people that would do the sleep hypnosis.
What?
Yeah. There was like this chick, and then there was this dude that looked like Tim Tebow that would do these sleep hypnosis things on YouTube. And like you could listen to them, and they would guide, it was like guided relaxation to sleep.
I love
and
it.
And that was how I kind of fixed the majority of my like being able to like fall asleep on command. But which then it flipped on the other side, because when I worked on the ambulance and stuff, like I got to where I could fall asleep sitting up anywhere. Like I can sleep on the side of the road. I've slept in stretchers. I've slept in, like, it's probably one of the most intense jobs I've ever worked, as I far bet. As like you just sleep whenever you can.
I know. I'm going to have to look up that sleep hypnosis, but that's funny that you say, you know, you might want to be careful because they're putting you in this hypnotic state, and then next thing you know, they're telling you to give them all their money.
You're the next activated Russian bot or something.
Exactly. Or yeah, like the Manchurian Candidate. They train you somehow. So
that's what I'm saying. It's like, but that's what I'm talking about. Is like with that, yeah, I'm as equally as wary about that as I'm talking about like with psychedelics. Of like your brain is something that's malleable. Like it's something that you can. It what we see is what we see because we believe that's real in front of us. Like I believe that this is a computer and that we're talking. And like all that is created, and that can all change. And I mean, you work in a, like I saw that on the ambulance, like dealing with psych patients.
Yes.
Like you, they are on a different planet. Like I dealt with many PTSD guys that you would be dealing with guys, homeless guys on the street, and you'd have to talk them down, and you just have to basically meet them in whatever universe they were on and talk to them. And just be like, it's okay, man. Like, you know, come with me. Like it's, and you just have to figure those things out. But it's, your brain is a very fragile thing.
It can be, for sure.
People take that lightly, I think that's the main issue that at the core of what we were talking about earlier.
Unfortunately, yeah, some people are not like mentally stable enough to do these types of things. And if you're on the verge of a psychotic break and you take one of these psychedelics, you're gonna regret it, probably.
Well, we all skate a line, too. I mean, everybody's like one trip's great, like one little deviation from, you know, crazy.
Psychotic. Yeah, well, then you have the Silicon Valley kind of trend for microdosing, and it's all the it's all the rage right now. So,
yeah, I think that's a little weird. I think anytime you're putting something in your system like constantly, that's like a small, even though, but I mean, how is that any different than, you know, drinking coffee or drinking, like it's so it's like,
yeah,
I'm not necessarily saying it's wrong. Like if it's wrong. Helps you, if it benefits you, if it does good things, but like if eventually it ends in, you know, whatever, like
well,
you
okay.
I just look at causation.
Yeah. I mean, I'm being ultra honest here. I was actually microdosing early last year for a strong couple of months. And at first it was cool, you know, and I felt like this clarity of mind and whatever, sharpness. But shit started getting a little slippery towards the end. I was just like, okay, I better go ahead and ease off of this. So
yeah, well, like anytime, like I said, is you're playing with that reality. You're playing with that. Like, is this physical? Is this actually happening, or is this? Am I creating this? Am I? But I mean, some people, that's what they're looking for too. Like, well, it's what are you trying to accomplish?
Yeah, I mean, because like a lot of people, maybe they're slightly depressed, or maybe they think they're depressed, even though like I have zero reason to be depressed at all. And at the moment, I'm not. But like, I probably was, and I was searching for something to, you know, different, and maybe it was
to mask that or to change that, or that's a hedge.
Probably just lonely or something, but you know what I mean. And so I'm just like filling that void with these substances, and it held the place. It was like a placeholder, but I'm in a much better place now. And you know what the deal is with Sheath and how well we're doing, and we're just growing. And I have like a lot of people that depend on me for their jobs, and yeah. whatever. So
well, see, that's something that a lot of these people, and I think that even like Gary has touched on, is that like people like really like to bark down at what they would call the man or the boss in quotes, you know, like, and they want to talk about the, it's like a lot of times the reason these guys are stressed out and like ringed out is because like, there's 400 people that rely on them to make their home payments. There's, yeah. you know, 250 people that have to, you know, make their health insurance payments off of their idea or their concept or their company. And so, like, that's a big weight that I think that gets really, like, forgotten about in the current.
Oh, yeah.
Well, there's the keeping up with the Joneses type pace that everybody's kind of created on this Instagram, which yeah. parlayed right into a really good moment. I was yes. like, did you pay attention to the like Instagram blackout yesterday? Because I got immense entertainment out of that.
tell me. We were sitting by the fire watching movies and stuff. What did you get entertained by? Because I know I've heard about it now.
Yeah, so like Instagram, yesterday morning, my job, like as far as how I've managed to like continue to train and do everything is I manage social media for a lot of different clients on wow. different levels. Like that's kind of what I do. And for the last 3.5-4 years, I've been like really, really deep inside the trenches of like running Facebook ads, Instagram ads, and YouTube, and kind of building those things. So that's where the Daily Stat came from, was kind of me meddling a little bit in my own brand and then taking that and scaling it to bigger brands. Nice. So, so my job revolves around social media. About it. I check my phone as often as an Instagram model. Like my wife gives me crap all the time, but, because like things like what happened yesterday happened. And so I went to go start uploading some things for, and a shout out to one of the main projects I'm working on is with the Kenny Kim and Dean Thomas from the UFC.
Oh, I know Dean.
We're doing, I'm working on with them on the trainbjjonline.com. So like
trainbjjonline.com.
Nice, that's nice. Their like where they're doing all kinds of different breakdowns and just techniques. It's taking my jiu-jitsu to the next level because I sit there and edit, you know, a tutorial for 4.5 hours from Dean Thomas or Kenny, or and they're starting to bring on like guest black belts and stuff. Like I get to sit there and like I basically break it down after watching them break it down. Like it's pretty cool.
That is cool. So, that's a great experience for you to like absorb that knowledge, I guess.
Oh dude, it's taken my jiu-jitsu getting to be able to, because I'm off on a rabbit trail, we'll come back. As a kid, like growing up in school, like where I fall in love with jiu-jitsu is I have trained and studied jiu-jitsu, and I was introduced to it by like the garage style, like jiu-jitsu. I got into it about like 7-8 years ago with some guys in Montgomery that were like some of the first guys that brought jiu-jitsu into Alabama or whatever. And we were training at like this, it was a taekwondo gym that one of the guys had a key to, and they would let us train after, you know, 8 p.m. after all the kids had gone home, as long as we mopped up. So like we wouldn't leave till like 2 a.m. sometimes. So that's like, and all it was just a bunch of dudes. I think the highest ranked guy was like maybe a purple belt or a brown belt. And like a bunch of dudes just showed up, slap hands and rolled. So like that's the jiu-jitsu that like I fell in love with. Yeah. Like just a bunch of dudes that show up and just roll.
That's like Fight Club sort of kind of.
Yeah. And so like I've never really there's the guys that are like the mat nerds that are like assassins, like absolutely good at what they do. Like I'm not talking trash in the realm of how they learn jiu-jitsu, but they'll be sitting there like with their notebooks and like the guys like showing things and they're like writing things down. Man, I'm lucky if I remember it from the time that he says, okay, everybody got it, to the time that I find a partner to go like drill it with.
Yeah.
Like I am that ADD. So like I have loved jiu-jitsu to the point that like I've been able to learn it. In it's a physical thing, like you actually have to do it over and over and over and over and over again. And so like this film stuff, like when my jiu-jitsu first took its first little like leap forward, I started filming myself. And like if anybody's doing anything, if you're like you're trying to make a jump shot better, if you're trying to like make your jiu-jitsu better, the first thing I ever tell anybody is like start filming yourself. Because like I learned that back when I swam when I was in high school, and one of my high school coaches was like one of the first coaches to like start filming swimmers underwater and like getting their like body structure and like, oh, your arms are in the wrong place and all this type of stuff. And he was doing that for like 14, 15 year olds. And so like that's where the film stuff has really kind of like parlayed into how I learn of I can watch myself do something and then go back and fix it. Because I promise you, the first time you do something, you do not look as cool as you think.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense, especially like with the jump shot. You don't even, you can't see yourself, so you don't know what you're doing. And when you see, you're like, oh, okay, that's how I was doing it so wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
So like you said, you grew up with like this anxiety and
yeah.
So, but this is one of the realizations that I had from the ayahuasca, and it was that maybe I need my anxiety. Maybe that's why I'm quasi, you know, moto successful, because I live in this state of anxiety, like nothing is good enough, you know, and I need to get better. And if everything was kosher, like water off a duck's back, like I have this friend, it's like nothing, he doesn't care. And I'm like, I don't know if that would be better. I would like to be this, you know, like careless sort of person that nothing bothers me. But at the same time, how successful can someone be when you don't really care about, like nothing bothers you?
I think it's about a lot of things. I think most of it's balance. I mean, the biggest thing that you can think of is there, you don't get put into a position that like is ever overwhelming. And so that's like, so I was talking about MMA and kind of like how that correlates to my life and things like that is it's a way for, it's something that I can train for and that it can get to the absolute worst and I can still control everything that's happening inside my head. So it's kind of like the same approach that I take in life of like, I mean, yeah, it could get hairy. It could get weird. Like things could like not work, but I mean, this is where we are. This is what we've been handed and this is what we have to deal with.
Yeah. You deal with the situation presented to you and you are, you know, you're doing something that you love and you're becoming like an expert at it. Like life, it's like life. Cause jiu-jitsu is like a never ending pursuit. You can never learn everything. And it's probably still evolving.
There's always somebody that can kick your ass. Like there's always somebody out there that can beat you.
Always.
Like no matter how good you are, there's always a better, like a better black belt, or there's somebody that knows something that you don't know. And the thing about combat sports is everybody's got their day. Yeah. Like somebody can beat anybody. You know, everyone has lost all along the way.
Yeah. And you have to lose over and over and over again in order to get better. If you just won every time you fought, you would not grow. I mean, you might be like, I mean, and I think of LeBron James or somebody that's just so gifted physically that they don't have to try as hard as other people and they just always win their whole life. But I'm sure he puts in a lot of effort.
Yeah, but like LeBron James, the thing about people like LeBron James is that like they're so, the ability to do what he has done and remain, and he hasn't remained like 100% humble. Like he's done some stupid stuff and he's done some stuff, but like for real, I don't really fault guys like that. Like I've always said, and I've heard people talk about like, I mean, you look at the Justin Biebers of the world or like the Hims, like, you don't know what it's like to be him. I mean, the dude can't go get a cup of coffee. Like the dude can't be. And for me, like as somebody who like, I don't like having human interaction sometimes. Like, you know, like I'm a normal, like I just want to go like have a bad day and go get a cup of coffee. Like I don't want to have to deal with anything. So like to get recognized from the moment you walk out of the door to the moment that like it, you can't imagine what that would be like. Not to mention the things that people, I mean, I haven't watched it, but have you seen there was something that I saw about LeBron's like early years that recently came out. Documentary?
I've seen a lot of footage of him from his early days and
like when he was in high school and they were talking about like when they were getting offers put on the table for you know, I mean, he was getting millions of dollars put across the table from him as a kid, you know, 15, 16 years old when he's getting recruited. And, you know, for him to keep the wherewithal to go, and I can't remember where the interview was that I saw, but he was like, he was talking about going back home to the hood where his mom was paying, you know, $10 a month for rent. And he had just gotten offered something that would like fix all of their problems. But he knew that it was short-sighted and he was going to be better than that.
Yeah.
And it's like, how do you keep that kind of maturity and wherewithal at 15 years old? Like when I played football in college, I was around scholarship players.
Yeah.
I wasn't a scholarship player. I was a preferred walk-on. So like I got all the same privileges, but I had to pay to be there.
LOL.
And but I saw guys just blow their checks on some of the dumbest, I mean, the dumbest things. I mean, I don't even like scooters, like things they didn't need, like just like, and it really wasn't that much money in their scholarship checks. I'm talking about like the amount of money that they spent or were given for like quote unquote rent or food.
Yeah, or spending money or whatever.
Yeah, the little spending money they get that, you know, somebody's got to pay back because like all these scholarships are just loans just in a different form. Like it's just they're like you're supposed to be go getting, which they call them, you know, student athletes, but. We all know that's not really the case, but.
Did you see that recent scandal about the Hollywood stars cheating?
I haven't gotten to read too much into it, but I did see that the chick from Full House
exactly.
is one of the main suspects.
I know, it's so funny. I mean,
it's sad though. Like those are people like those, when I watch the breakdown of like how the people that end up in those programs, not necessarily this scam, but like the people that pay their way into these Ivy League schools, there's people that are equally like, if not far more brilliant than the people that are there that are getting cheated out of the system by people that are doing stuff like this. So that's where like, that's kind of a special, like, oh, come on, that's messed up to do that to like, it's an education system. Like, and so that's where it's
funny. I think it's hilarious. And I mean, not to be weird, but I hope, how they get penalized just cause I don't know why they're already like in this elite status and they're already, you know, rich enough.
Yeah, why are you cheating the system already? Like, why do you need to cheat the system to go to an Ivy League school? Like, as if that's going to give the woman. But that's also the hamster wheel that we've created as a society. So, like, you know, to say that anybody else put in similar circumstances, like, what would people, like, be doing is if they were presented with like the only way to advance, which I mean, that sounds absurd.
It
like
does sound
coming from like born into the situation that they're born into. I mean, just capitalize on what you got. Like we all were born with the hand that we were handed, like play it. Like
yeah.
don't cheat to win more.
I know you're already like in an elite kind of status. And then you want to, I don't know. It's like, I think it was a status symbol. My daughter's going to Harvard or my son's going to Yale instead of,
which is really, unless you're one of the like top like 0.0% that really actually deserve to be there, and that actually, you know, are the brilliant people that are pushing our, you know, that are pushing our, you know, species forward, like really all that is a status. I mean, college essentially is that piece of paper shows. And I graduated college, but I used to joke with my dad that I was a Rhodes Scholar because I went to 5 different schools, RAAD Scholar, because I couldn't decide what I wanted to do, and I still can't decide what I want to do.
My LOL. Life.
But but it's one of those things too that like what I learned in school and what I learned at college was a lot of things that are valuable and things that I apply even to this day. I mean, there are many times that I'm sitting in business meetings and I'm glad that I went through, you know, business classes.
Yes.
So, you know, like, cause there's times that I'll hear people that I know don't know what they're talking, like didn't take those basics and don't know the basics of you know, the industry of how to run a business. And you'll be sitting in a meeting, you'll hear somebody say something, and you're like, you don't know how this works, do you?
Yeah. I mean, I went
to. It doesn't work like that.
Yeah, I went to business school. I got my MBA. But unlike you, I don't really remember too much. But it did kind of fill in. I guess it filled in some gaps. And what I got out of it was I was actually running Sheath while I was getting my MBA. So I was able to apply the. Like the lesson to my business. And, you know, when you're getting a master's degree, most of it is a project, and it's usually like a research project, and you have to do a presentation. and all of my projects were on Sheath.
So you just did it on your company. Well, I mean, so you do, remember. Yeah. You do remember some of those concepts. You just have now applied them to where they're now your own concepts, really, because you built it alongside.
Yeah, it definitely gave me practice. I guess one of the best things I got out of it was you had to present to the class every project, and I used to be mortified standing in front of the class or anyone. And even during the, you know, while I was getting my degree, I would just get so nervous and, you know, be like freaking out. Yeah. But you just have to do it and do it and do it until you're not freaked out anymore. And in fact, I gave this, was like a keynote speech at this Inventors Roundtable kind of convention. And there were thousands of people there. There weren't thousands of people watching me, but there were thousands of people at the event. And it went so good. I was so proud of myself because, like, and it was weird because, like, I almost cried as I was giving the speech because it was, like, retelling the story of kind of how I got to where I am, which is not all that glamorous, trust me, but, like, still, I have come a long way, you know? And when you realize, like, all of the obstacles that you've overcome and you never gave up, it's, you know, you... Anyways, I inspired a lot of people. Like, everyone in the crowd almost came up afterwards and was like, that was inspiring. And they shook my hands and they gave me a hug and this and that. It was, that made me feel good. And so, and that's like I said, like this evolution that probably started from while I was getting my degree. And, you know, they're saying, you know, telling kids these days that it's not important to go to college. And to an extent, I agree with that. Yet, there's, you know, there's benefits and cons. You know, you could just either right at 18, start your own company, learn as you go, or go and get some more specialized training for a few more years and then start. You know, it's like different options. I don't know.
Well, and you're going to take the biggest thing about starting a business is for anybody they need to understand is like they're going to take losses.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's going to be things that don't work. And sometimes like the first idea you started off with or the first business you started off with isn't what's in your hand 6 years later.
Nope.
Like you have to be willing to evolve and keep rolling with the punches and keep going, because if you don't, like so there's the learning curve. And I think that that's what college or especially like master's programs when you get into that. But like, I think college was meant to be like, you figure that out during that time period. But now like life happens so fast that it's kind of better to just kind of like learn at the same time as you're going, because it's going to change by the time you get there.
Exactly.
So like that's really been the self-education, which has always blown my mind that people don't do, is like, I was the same way, like in high school and whatnot. I hated reading in public. Like I didn't want to like, because I never wanted to be, you know, just like any kid, I didn't want to be called stupid. And so like all of my spare time, I was just like reading like encyclopedias and Googling stuff. So like part of the reason I started a podcast was because my wife got tired of listening to me talk. Huh? Like, is that I just find interesting people and interesting things to talk about, because I've literally read at least an article on anything possible, because that's just how I've always been. So it blows my mind more people don't do it, because you have the entire, you know,
world
at your fingertips. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
It's like, why are you not just, if you have a thought or a question, why are you asking, why aren't you just Googling it? Or, you know, which I don't know, like some people could argue that now that's, you know, limited information that you're getting and yada, yada, yada. If you want to go down some, you know, Eddie Bravo wormholes, but.
Yes, Eddie Bra. Eddie Bra.
Just look into it. Just look into it.
I mean, I get a lot of my information from Joe Rogan, you know, and then you look deeper into it or whatever, but. Sometimes you
He's
don't
a good springboard, man. Like people talk trash and like they kind of like crap on Joe Rogan the same way that people do on like Nickelback, which is like, come on, like they produced like great albums that everyone was buying. So either the entire country was wrong.
I know, it's so, I don't understand that metaphor. Like Nickelback was not a good band. I mean, at the time they were good, and still to this day, if one of their songs came on, you might be like, you know, feeling it. I don't know.
Oh, dude. I mean, well, everybody can at least sing one line from a Nickelback song. So, I mean, like, that's a success in a business aspect. Like, hey, it's like Red Bull. My mom would never drink a Red Bull, but everyone knows what a Red Bull is.
Like, everyone knows who Nickelback is, so they must have done something
exactly.
Right.
So that's what I'm saying. It's like Joe Rogan gets crapped on about being, you know, the Oprah for meatheads. But, I mean, hey, he's got some good information and some good springboards.
Dude, he is the Oprah for meatheads. But
he leans into it, too. That's why I think it's hilarious.
I love it. I was just listening to him on this morning about this Renee something or other talking about the Russian.
Oh, yeah, I haven't listened to that one yet. I saw it looked interesting.
Yeah, it's pretty good. You know, the Russian bots and Russian.
I wonder if they survived the Facebook, Instagram shutdown of 2019. I think that's where we started on this whole, like, I think I was talking about that, and then we went down a massive
wormhole. Well, and that's a great circle back, and we're gonna wrap it up here. But yeah, maybe they started that issue, or maybe it was the weather.
I don't know. Maybe it is. There is. Are y'all dealing with some snow up there? Are y'all snowed in?
Yeah, two snow days in a row. It's very unlikely for the schools around here, but it's pretty calm outside. So yeah. I don't know how that would have affected, you know, this Instagram and Facebook, but maybe it's just a coincidence.
I just assumed that it's apocalypse. I just figured that finally the what is the old Bill Hicks joke about? I figured that the that California had finally shaken off the face of the planet and we had quiet Arizona Bay.
Hey, that'd be some good real estate then, finally.
Yeah, you know, I got beachfront property in Arizona, man.
That was a great song.
I don't know. I'm referencing the Bill Hicks joke. That's all I know.
We need to wrap it up because we're coming up on our time. I really appreciate you joining me and taking the time out of your day. I know you're very busy. Totally. Maybe I can come on your podcast, The Daily Stack.
I'd love to have you on, man.
Yeah, that'd be great. I love doing these too. Just to get a good conversation in and kind of get a sense of your own ideas when you're in this kind of tunnel vision, you know, where it's just you and me instead of the phones and all that.
Well, and a lot of my philosophy on the podcasting is that, like, the open air conversation where you're having, you know, open discourse. Like, if a dude has to come on here and defend his political standpoint for 2.5 hours, you know who that dude is at the end of 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
So, you know, people show who they are in a conversation, and, you know, it's eliminating echo chambers is what I really think is what podcasting can do.
Yeah.
It's just being able to be open and have a conversation.
Yeah, and a full expression of an idea, not getting cut off in the 3-minute segment or whatever.
Yeah.
So very cool. I love it. We're going to keep doing it. This is the Robert Patton Global Podcast RPG. Thank you for joining me again. Isaac Stackhouse, follow him on Instagram.
At The Daily Stack.
The Daily Stack. You can probably get him on Facebook.
Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, iTunes, SoundCloud, everything.
Yeah, follow him on YouTube.
YouTube.
Thank you for joining me. We'll talk to you again soon. If you have anything else you want to say, you can say it.
And also check out my main project that I'm working on right now. It's the trainbjjonline.com. That's with Kenny Kim and Dean Thomas. It's a definitely a good resource for jiu-jitsu guys.
Good luck with that. Everyone check that out. And we will see you next time. Until then, peace and love, baby.
Peace and love, baby.